welcome back to our podcast for the Sustainable FinTech Program. I'm Zoe and I'm the program coordinator. We're here today with Ishan Dan from Magenix. Ishan, good to have you here.
Hi Zoe, thank you for having me.
How are you?
I'm excellent, thank you.
That's awesome. Can you tell me a bit more about yourself and Magenix?
So I'm the sole founder and CEO of Magenix. It was basically my background. I was a stockbroker for about, 10 to 20 years. So during COVID, I decided to quit my job and take my package and decide to do something positive to the planet. Well, not yet, but hopefully on the way. And create a investment platform that helps people invest in sustainable projects. And it's so far, it's been about a 2-year journey. And it's only recently that now the wheels are really starting to turn. So yeah, it's been a really good journey.
So what made you become a founder? Is this something you always wanted to do, or did that really just pop up 2 years ago?
No, it's actually been something that I've always had that urge. I've always had that entrepreneurial sort of urge. I launched a app very early on called Mr. Tradey. It wasn't a success. And that was a while back. So I've always wanted, and I guess the reason that wasn't a success was because it was in an industry that I didn't really know a lot about. So I learned a lot from that. And then I think this second time around, I've made that move and decided, yep, I definitely wanted to do this, yeah.
Awesome. And what makes you love being a founder? So why do you wake up every morning being excited about what you do?
Because I don't have to catch the train or drive to work, which is really awesome. I can get it whenever I want. No, not that at all. I think my own autonomy, just a company that's growing and living and breathing it every single day. That's what gets me up in the morning. That's what made me want to be a founder, I guess. Yeah.
Awesome. Let's talk about Magenix a bit more. What's the problem you're solving? We've already touched on that, but if you could go a bit more in depth on that and the solution you've developed.
Yeah, sure. So I guess this all came about. I used to be a mining stockbroker. So I used to raise money for mining companies. And as we all know, climate change has become a real, it's a massive, massive problem. And Australia, late to the equation, sort of jumped on board and signed the Paris Accord. So within the next 10 to 20 years, Australia will look to decarbonize. And that's a huge change from going from fossil fuels, coal and gas, to completely renewable energy. And as it stands at the moment, that renewable energy / sustainable project space is exclusive to ultra high net worths and your institutional investors as well as super funds. So normal high net worths, normal investors can't get access to those sorts of projects, any direct access. So what I wanted to do on the buy side, that is the impact investment side, I wanted to create a investment platform that, first of all, gives access to impact investors to these projects. And number two, cuts down high investment barriers, and it creates a liquid marketplace. On the sell side are the climate positive projects. So for argument's sake, a solar power project. So by connecting the two and creating a marketplace, I'm enabling private capital to be channeled into that climate positive project. So I'm helping fund that project. And a funny fact was, a surprising fact was there was 663 projects that were only partially funded.
So Ishan, how does Magenix contribute to a more sustainable financial ecosystem?
At the moment, you're probably aware the main way people invest into sort of green investors via ESG, which is just filtering out stocks, but it's not direct. That sort of investing isn't direct, directly into the project itself. So what my company, Magenix, will do, Magenix will provide a capital raising platform and create a marketplace so that we can help funnel private capital into these climate positive projects, but also we'll also be able to measure the impact and its quantifiable, measurable impact that it creates on the planet. So basically, we will, our platform will further increase the flow of funds into these projects, I guess. Yeah.
Awesome. What countries are you operating right now, and where are you looking to go?
So at the moment, we're Australia only, I'm locally Australia. But after that, we're looking at going possibly to Singapore. Singapore share a very similar family office network like Australia does. And then after that, we're probably looking to go to Dubai or Mauritius, actually.
Cool, cool. What's your traction like? Talk to me about user numbers, revenue, all of that.
Okay, so we're still pre-revenue and we're still in the proof of concept stage. But we have, along the way, put together, I mean, we've created and put together a list of maybe 2,000, maybe a bit over 2,000, the early developers, I call them, or early adopters that have sort of been really interested with the IDN concept and jumped on board along the way. On the other side, we have a really big solar power developer that has 51 projects that they're looking to build in Australia. So we've got a long pipeline of climate positive projects that are just waiting to come on board. The next big move is to start onboarding family offices and a network of wealth advisors.
So where do you see yourself in the next 12 months, yourself and Regenix?
Myself and Regenix, okay. Maybe on a yacht on an island. No. within our roadmap, so within the next 6 months, after we raise pre-seed raising and then have the MVP will be developed within 6 months, and then we're looking to launch 2025. So that, what's that, eight months from now. So within 12 months, the platform will be up and running, and projects will be using the platform to be, receive funding, yeah.
So you said you're raising. How much are you raising?
For the pre-seed raising, we've put a figure of $250,000 just for pre-seed, when pitching overseas, we might actually go for a bit more because of expansion plans. But yeah,
what would you use the funding for?
Okay, so the funding for the $250,000 pre-seed, that will be entirely used for to complete the entire dashboard, and that's tech development. And we've got a partnership with a company that's taking that on board, and all that, and that will include the proof of concept with the Australian Stock Exchange and their infrastructure and one solar power developer. And then following that, we'll have a prototype that's also developed as well.
So what has been your favorite learning objective? This can be either about raising or Regenix in general, being a founder. What has been the most essential thing to you?
The biggest thing and the hardest thing, so when during COVID, I was on a really good high paying job, and I decided to leave that job and follow a dream. And the hardest part was when I did decide to do that. If you think back 3 years ago, that was before the crypto boom. What Regenix, the tech that it uses, is called asset tokenization. That word wasn't even, Australia didn't even, that word wasn't even spoken about. And so my idea, there was no one doing that here at all. Then the FTX collapse happened and the crypto collapse happened. And so then I had to, it was a really tough time because no one was raising capital. No one would touch blockchain projects, even though the project was not a crypto project at all. So it was only until I sort of went overseas and I spoke to, a guy that runs a big platform in Singapore, and he said, no, look, don't give up. You are on the right track. The hardest part is actually believing, because I guess you got to believe in yourself and forecast and project forward 6 months to a year, and and you got to believe in yourself, and you see all the indicators, even though some of them are negative, but you still got to believe in yourself, and you know that you're right, and there's so many people around you that are saying, no, I don't think it's going to happen. That was the hardest thing. But now, and even BlackRock 3 years ago, they're a big US fund manager. They were heavily against cryptocurrency and blockchain. It's only now that they've changed it, their tune. So now the markets have changed, and I actually went to a rooftop party two years ago. There was about 600 people there. So I went
on
to
one rooftop
In the city. It was huge. And I revisited that same party. It would have been maybe about 80 people. So it was like the last man standing.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
So you talked about asset tokenization. For those that don't know what that is, can you summarize asset tokenization in 2 to 3 sentences?
Yeah, so it basically is just a fancy word it's for digitizing, then breaking that digital piece up into different bits. So for argument's sake, let's say if you wanted to invest in a solar power project, what asset tokenization does is it breaks down, for argument, to invest in a solar power project, the minimum investment amounts are too high, and because they're too high, they're barriers to entry and it's illiquid. But by breaking down that solar power project into many thousands of little bits, those bits are the tokens. That's what asset tokenization is. And basically, it's the tokenization of the project will actually be stored in a fund, and then that fund will be tokenized.
Sishan, what made you join Startup Bootcamp?
What made me join Startup Bootcamp? Right. So when Regenex, when we were trying to raise money, it was at a time where no one understood what asset tokenization was, and the crypto ICO boom, just the pump and dump, well, that had just imploded, and a lot of VCs had lost money. Interest rates had gone up, inflation had gone up, and no one was investing in anything. So it was nearly impossible. No one wanted to hear my story of asset tokenization except one person, and it was Trevor. And he understood it inside out because his background is from a traditional finance. So he loved it. And I wasn't actually a big fan of accelerators because I thought I knew everything because I've done a degree, whatever. So I thought, okay, we'll give it a go, accelerator. And it changed. It changed everything I knew about how a startup should work. Yeah.
So what role did SBC play in your development as a company?
So as a company, right from the start, it was the Amsterdam trip that made the most difference, because during that trip, you really took the product, you paired it, pulled it right back to the start, and then you put it back together again. So one of the biggest changes that Regenex made was we were looking to tokenize existing funds by fund managers. That was the wrong way to go. And then so what we looked at doing is to bypass the fund manager and go straight to the climate project, because that's essentially what we're trying to solve. And I didn't see that. Yes, there were a lot of changes that, and there were a lot of network connections, because Europe are a lot further ahead in the climate space than Australia, obviously.
So in December, we took the Sustainable FinTech cohort to Amsterdam for a week full of speakers. We went to Future Expo, which was a huge event organized by Startup Bootcamp. So what was your favorite thing about that week?
The favorite thing about the Amsterdam, it was the speakers. The speakers were really, really good. And just to go out, meet CBA or meet ING or meet venture capital firm from Dubai. That was really interesting, and for them to actually take an interest in each of our startups was really good.
So weeks 10 and 11 of the program have been very focused on investment, and we call them investment weeks. How have they helped you as a company, and what role has SBC played in your raise?
With Regenex, right from the start, if you look at how we started off to where we are now, the journey's been amazing, and we've changed so much. I remember the first week in Amsterdam, I had a pitch deck of 50 slides. I had a $6 million raising amount for pre-seed, and there's no reason for it. I just wanted to raise. Yeah, and then and then from then on to now, fast forward to now, investment readiness has showed the full stages, the step stages, and exactly how we're raising and tailored to different investors. And it's helped tailor the entire the entire process a lot more, a lot more tight knit and with a focus. Yeah.
So you said in the beginning you had 50 slides in your deck. Yes. How many slides do you have now?
Well, I'd still have 50 if I could, but obviously we've cut that down to I think Bangkok is five slides.
Awesome.
I was thinking about just making them really small but no.
So your confidence in pitching, obviously going from 50 slides to five or even max of 10, how has that changed the way you pitch and what has that done to your confidence?
You see, interestingly, when I first started off, those 50 slides were like written, it was like a white paper just in 50 slides. So I'd look off the slides and read from the slides. Now, obviously what's happened is I'm pitching with confidence. I know the story inside out, and the slides are just more or less like a visual guide. They're not there for people to sort of to read off, and that's changed everything because the story, people are listening to the story that I'm telling, whereas before they were trying to focus on the slides. Yeah.
So obviously at SBC we focus a lot on the pitch practices every week. Do you think they've been good in your development? Do you think that was your favorite thing of the program?
See, I hated the pitch practice every week. See, I was never ready, and then you'd call my name out, and I'd be like, oh crap. So I'd try and pitch and sort of look at something, but in a roundabout way, I recently pitched at the Accounting Business Expo in March, and I was really worried that I didn't. I don't know why, I was a little bit nervous, but when I got on stage, everything just flowed. I didn't even think. Everything just flowed, and it all came out really easily. And I was super confident on the stage, and there was not a single. And I guess it sort of made me remember when I was pitching every weekend, every week. <yeah.
laughs> Awesome. So what did you love most about the Sustainable FinTech program that you were part of for 12 weeks?
See, what's funny is I've sort of joined a little tiny accelerator, I'm the name, and the difference with Startup Bootcamp is huge. Startup Bootcamp, it's the team and the cohort that you sort of, it's like you're graduating from uni with a team of startups that go through the journey with you and help each other out. I mean, I've got lifetime friends now with about three or four of the startups that are, and we've helped each other out. And you really form some really good connections through the program. So it's not just a startup where there's, goodbye after it finishes. It does have some good networking.
Cool. How's the program and the people helped you overcome any challenges that you faced over the past couple of months?
So when I first started Regenex, I guess comparing to a lot of the other startups, they sort of had already created a prototype, or they were on an MVP. And I guess one of the biggest challenges that I faced at the start, I felt like I was a bit behind the ball. But fast forward to now, we were all in the same situation. We were all in the same. And that what Startup Bootcamp did was it sort of, it looked at everybody's, irrespective of where you were in the journey. And that sort of, that first of all, that helped because, and then secondly, the support and mentorship that you gave, especially with the mentors that you provided us with, that helped every week. Whatever little questions we had, so that we didn't feel like we were on this journey alone. So that was good.
Have there been any conversation with mentors that have really stood out to you or been extremely valuable?
Okay. Probably two mentors that have stayed with stayed with RegenX and have provided unbelievable support will be Paul Mitchison and Alan Shields. They both have showed unbelievable support for the the entire time, and they even after the SBC program finished, they still stayed on board and helped. But likewise, also all the mentors were good, and Nat from the ASX, she's probably one of the best. She obviously stayed. There's a partnership with the ASX, so she was a mentor as well, and she still is a mentor up to today. And the rest of them have all been good, and they've contributed in one way or another.
Cool. So let's talk about Demo Day.
Yeah.
We are going to Money 2020 Asia. This will be in Bangkok, 23rd to 25th of April. What are you excited about the most?
What am I excited about? I love Thai food, and not just that. I'm excited about the actual event itself, and pitching at. I mean, just looking at the video, the trailer, it looks like it's going to be a really, really good event. So the opportunity to pitch to everyone that's in Asia that represents a financial or a climate tech institution, the opportunity to pitch to them and tell my story, well, in five slides, but not just that, to make sure that the audience understands my story in the best way possible. But not only that, also to ensure that I deliver that message confidently, I ensure that I can nail a few investors that are prepared to invest in the development of RegenX.
Cool. So what are you looking forward to most?
I'm actually looking forward to the entire cohort, the team, SBC. And the last time we really met was in Amsterdam. And that last event that SBC put on, that's when the team was really together. Because, I mean, some of the team are in Europe, some of them in America, some of them in Africa. So to catch up together is probably one of the most exciting things.
So what's one thing you wish you knew before starting this whole process of founding a company and becoming a founder?
Hindsight's a wonderful thing. But one of the things that... actually was very time consuming was trying to find the right way to raise capital. I mean, if I knew that if I had applied for SBC early on, I probably wasted probably about a year. I had one guy that was a capital, he was a capital raising specialist, and he charged me $5,000 per month, and then after 3 months didn't actually deliver anything. and there's so many people that come in and say that they can help you and that, but yeah, they don't actually provide any. What SBC does is it is really unique, and it is it really makes a huge difference. To not only that, like, basically SBC hold your hand and guide you also with the networks that SBC has, as well as being able to confidently pitch and tell your story. It all fits together.
So if you could do one thing differently, what would that be?
Join up early. straight away. And then, it's all a learning curve. It's all a learning experience, I guess. Yeah.
If an aspiring or even existing startup founder came up to you asking for one piece of advice, what would you tell them?
Yeah. Being a founder isn't for everyone. It is a really, really lonely, tough journey. And the hardest thing about being a founder, startup founder, is that you're bringing either an idea into the market that hasn't been proven, hasn't been tested. So there's a a massive risk in that, and you pretty much give up everything to follow that dream. What my biggest piece of advice is, don't ever give up that dream, because you'll get people around you that'll put you down. They will say, you know, that's not going to work, you know. And especially, and it could be like institutions, it could be banks, it could be fund managers that do it, and they're supposed to be, you know, they've got teams of research analysts. But the thing is, if you see that vision and you have that dream, the best thing you can do to fulfill that dream is, like for me, it was finding Startup Bootcamp that understood that dream and believed in it with me. So that helped my journey along the way. Yeah.
Cool. I think that's it from us. Thank you, Ishan, for being on here.
Anytime. Thank you for everything.
And we're looking forward to seeing you guys again on our next podcast.
Thanks, guys.
Good job.
Oh, yes. Well done.
Is that right?
Excellent.